Watson continued to experiment on babies and other living things until his star began to fade. At the end of his life, he wrote nostalgically of his failure to put together what he considered the ultimate experiment in social engineering, a multi-ethnic baby farm. "I sometimes think I regret," Watson wrote, "that I could not have a group of infant farms where I could have brought up 30 pure-blooded Negroes on one, 30 pure-blooded Anglo-Saxons on another, and 30 Chinese on a third, all under similar conditions." Watson's dream may seem bizarre to modern ears, but implicit in the concept was a real desire to see the question of race answered once and for all. He was not unlike thousands of other researchers at prestigious universities across the United States.
In the late 19th century, alongside the rise of Jim Crow segregation in the 1890s, what you saw is that corporations developed a much more elaborate way to justify the fact that the wealthy corporate elite, which was without exception white, to explain the reason why. That reason has its basis in what became known as the eugenics movement. You were born with either good genes or not good genes.
In the case of Miss Mason, I can see no reason for the operation that's been recommended. The girl is perfectly normal. She's hardworking and has a good reputation.
Do you know anything about her family background?
Oh, yes, Your Honor, I do.
There are several other children, aren't there?
Yes.
What is their condition?
One is a cripple. Two others might be classed as feeble-minded.
Isn't the oldest son in jail?
Well, yes, I believe so.
And knowing all that, you still contend that this girl should be allowed to bring more people like that into the world?
Those who have good genes should be encouraged to reproduce, and those who are, quote, unfit should be discouraged from reproducing, from having children. That eventually went into forced sterilization programs, which started in the United States, directed against African Americans, Native Americans, immigrants in particular.
Eugenics was a pseudoscience rooted in the idea that you can, A, recognize pre-biologically determined differences in people based on their ethnicity, and that, B, you could construct a policy that favors some ethnic groups over others, both in terms of immigration policy and in terms of integration into U.S. society based on this hierarchy of heredity. This pseudoscience, this philosophy, gained a lot of traction in the United States amongst the industrialist class, especially at a time when immigrant workers, who made up a large percentage, if not the majority, of workers at the turn of the 20th century, were beginning to form unions, were beginning to create collective organizations, their own political parties, to challenge the conditions of industrialization, which were horrific and oppressive. It took root in the universities. It took root amongst the highest offices of government. Calvin Coolidge, for instance, Republican president, believed that, and even stated his belief that, a lot of social problems were associated with inferior races. We see ultimately this philosophy is going to play an important role in shaping immigration policy after the passage of the Immigration Act of 1924, which essentially creates a national quota system that favors immigrants based on their ethnicity and based on their nationality.
One fact that is important to understand about the eugenics movement is that it was created and funded by the corporate elites that ruled America coming into the 20th century. It was the Rockefellers, the Harrimans, the Kellogg family of the cereal. They funded these research programs at universities. all of it created, funded by these corporate families. The Rockefellers, in particular, played a particularly devious role. As the eugenics movement developed, it went in a really horrible direction.
Haben gegen dieses Gesetz der natürlichen Auslese in den letzten Jahrzehnten furchtbar gesündigt. Wir haben unwertes Leben nicht nur erhalten, wir haben ihm auch Vermehrung gewährt. Die Nachkommen dieser Kranken sahen so aus.
The Rockefellers would play a key role in the advancement of social engineering in the years between the Great Wars. Between 1922 and 1929, an arm of the Rockefeller Foundation gave out almost $50 million toward the pursuit of the social sciences around the world. According to historian Judith C. Lander, the spur was a need for better organization in society at large. What had begun as a public relations ploy to assuage public anger in the face of unscrupulous business practices and violent suppression of working people, the Rockefeller charities would set out to change society as a whole.
The Yale Institute of Human Relations was founded in 1929. It was given us $7 million initially from the Rockefeller Foundation just a couple of months before Black Tuesday occurred in October of 1929. So according to my calculations, if you factor in all the money that Rockefeller eventually gave the Yale Institute and the other monies from the government, this was the largest social science project that's ever been funded in history.
The desire for better order was epitomized by the Hawthorne experiments, which created a new model for organizing and supervising industrial workers. They are widely credited with putting the human factor back into industrial relations. Yet, as with previous experiments in the workplace, the ultimate effect would be to increase the power of the great capitalists at the expense of everyone else. The story of what is now termed scientific management, or Taylorism, begins decades earlier when Frederick Winslow Taylor was hired by Bethlehem Steel to increase efficiency in the industrial workplace. Once upon a time, the greatest theorist of the free market, Adam Smith, had warned that division of labor would create a catastrophe for human society. Frederick Taylor disagreed. In Taylor's view, there was far too little division of labor. Factories could be run far more efficiently if tasks were mechanized and broken down even further. In a series of experiments, he set out to reduce every task performed in a factory into individual units, measuring how long they took and setting targets for workers to meet. On its surface, scientific management seems like an excellent idea. Increased efficiency allows more products to be manufactured in a shorter amount of time. Yet there was another, more sinister motivation lurking in the background. Ever since the 19th century, machine shops had been a bastion of skilled labor. What this meant was that a considerable degree of power remained concentrated on the shop floor. The same skills that made production possible also enabled machinists to challenge management when they felt they were being treated unfairly. For management, this was an unacceptable bargaining chip. For Taylor, it was simply inefficient.
You find that the man does not change very much, whatever else changes. They burst in the aeroplane world, it will take some other countries a generation to catch up with our quality. And it is not because their engineers are inferior, but because our ordinary workmen have a tradition of skill behind them.
Taylorism was certainly about de-skilling. It was about studying what skilled workers did to decompose those tasks into their basic elements, and then teaching people to do specific aspects of it without learning the entire set of or array of activities that were involved and are involved for a skilled person. In that sense, it's a mechanism of control, because you dictate to people, well, you do this part of the entire task and you don't do anything else, and you dictate to 8, 10, or 12 people various specific aspects of the whole task, rather than allowing a skilled person to decide how the entire task should be done. So there's very much control involved there. To the degree that this involves de-skilling and involves control, it tends to take power away from workers. It takes power away from, therefore, the collectivity of workers, and therefore makes them less likely to be rebellious, makes them less likely to form various kinds of movements that would operate against, let's say, broadly, the capitalist system. So this is something that management thinks is a good idea for the workers, but is not a good idea for them. They have to be free to be creative. And in fact, Henry Ford, in his biography, said exactly that. Basically, he said something like, I'm too smart to have these kind of rational principles imposed on me, but those stupid workers out there, we need to impose those principles on them, because they wouldn't know what to do if we didn't impose those principles on them. So rationalization, McDonaldization, is always something that those on top want to impose on the bottom, but something they don't want to affect their work at all. Henry Ford, in effect, invented the automobile assembly line and more generally the system that came to be known as Fordism. One aspect of Fordism had to do with hierarchical control over workers, and more specifically, the control over workers by the assembly line. So all a worker might do, for example, is put a hubcap on a car as that car went past, as it was being constructed on the assembly line. So instead of a thinking, creative, skilled worker, you had a kind of mindless kind of worker who repetitively did the same task over and over again. Well, that kind of worker is robot-like. You are forced into a series of robot-like actions. The most interesting thing for me about McDonaldization, or Weber's broader concept of rationalization, is the idea of the irrationality of rationality. That these rational systems inevitably spawn all sorts of irrational consequences. This is supposed to be an efficient system, yet it ends up being very often inefficient. It's dehumanizing, one of the kind of ultimate irrationalities from my point of view.
In their study, Where Have All the Robots Gone?, Harold Shepard